So we're going to continue Tehilim, Psalms, Perek Mem Bet, and Mem Gimel. Today we'll do actually two chapters. They're not too long, but they are a little bit difficult to understand. They're very poetic. Nonetheless, very important ideas being expressed over here. Much of it has to do with the future, where David HaMelech turns to every one of us and asks us to reflect a little bit what we had and what we don't have anymore. In other words, this is a prophecy about the Beit HaMikdash, the temple that will be built, and unfortunately, the destruction or the diaspora that will follow. It says, reflect on what you once upon a time had, what things were like, the relationship you had with Hashem, and how you've become distant. So, Lamnatzech Maskil Livne Korach. This is for the conductor, however, this is also to the sons of Korach, which in itself needs an explanation. What are the children of Korach doing over here? And what is the word maskil doing here? The word maskil means to enlighten, for one to take note of these things, for one to awaken and realize awareness. In other words, these are things that are either being said by the children of Korach, the ones that remained alive. According to the Midrash, not all of his children died when the earth swallowed them up. Some regretted choosing the side of their father instead of choosing Moshe. But at the last moment, they changed their mind and they went with Moshe. So they remained alive and they composed certain songs that were incorporated into Tehillim. After all, they were considered prophets. They had prophetic visions about the future, about the destruction of the temple, the long diaspora. And David HaMelech is including these prophecies here, that which they composed. Or it's also could be that David HaMelech composed this, however, he's giving them over to the children of Korach, meaning the Leviim. They are the ones who are the Meshorarim, they are the ones that sing the songs. And therefore, he's calling them B'nai Korach. Otherwise, the rabbis do say that three children, Asaf, Elkanah, and Avi Asaf, are the ones who composed these songs. In other words, according to that opinion. And David HaMelech included this mizmor in the Sefer of Tehillim. And he begins, Ke'ayal tarog alafikei mayim. This is a very famous pasuk, a very famous verse. Songs have been made of this. It is a beautiful verse that describes a deer that is longing for water. There's a grammatical problem over here. On the one hand, it says ayal. Ayal is a male deer. On the other hand, it says ta'arog. Ta'arog means to long, but it's using the female way of expressing longing. Instead of ya'arog, it says ta'arog. So how could it be talking about an ayal, which is a male deer, and then using the verb ta'arog, which is describing the female that is longing? So the rabbis explain that there are two types of longing, the male deer and the female deer. One is being described here as longing for water, looking for water. Another idea that is expressed by the rabbis is that the female deer sometimes has a difficult time in giving birth. It is in pain. It does not come easy to her. And Hashem sends a snake to somehow give her a bite. And that's how it releases the calf. Now, even though the rabbis say this in describing the birth of a deer, that it involves a snake, we may not see that today, that a snake is involved in helping the mother deer give birth. What it means is intervention from above. That birth does not come about easy for some reason for this animal. And somehow, in an act of nature, which is really an act of God, by intervention of God, this comes about. So there is a longing. There is a certain cry coming out from the deer that reaches heaven. Mm-hmm. But the main emphasis over here is the cry or the longing of the male deer, and it could apply to either one, who's searching for water. So, kayal ta'arog al afikei mayim, as a deer cries longingly for brooks of water. Afikei mayim means little brooks, so it could just quench its thirst anywhere where it could find water. Ken nafshi ta'arog elecha Elohim, in the same way, my soul thirsts for God, thirsts for you, my God. So here David HaMelech compares himself, or compares his cry, his longing, to a deer. What's so significant about the longing of the deer? Because the deer, we are told, is the most compassionate of animals. When it searches for water, it does not only have itself in mind, it has all the animals in mind. And because of that, when it longs and it cries out, its cry reaches Shamayim, reaches heaven, and as a result of that, Hashem has mercy and sends the deer the water, points the way where he could find his food, his water, which then he shares with the rest of the animals that need it as well. The thirst for water over here does not only mean water. Obviously, David HaMelech has other ideas in mind when he says, or when he compares himself to a deer in search of water. What's water? Well, water means survivability. Water means life. And David HaMelech is saying, I cannot survive without God. In the same way that a deer searches and longs for water, I search a connection with God. I want to be close to Him. I cannot be without Him. Ken nafshi ta'arog elecha Elohim. In other words, in the same way that a deer wants this water, needs this water, I also need you. Besides the necessity of God, commentaries explain that this also describes the ultimate goal that every human being should aspire for, and that is shlemut, to complete himself. Shlemut means to complete itself, to be close to God, to be spiritual. That's called shlemut, refining one's character. And one should look at those goals as not only as something that is optional, something that is good, but something that is a necessity. One is not complete in this world unless he has a keshe, unless he has a connection with God, a very close connection. Unless he strives for that, he's wasting his time in this world. What are we here for? Just to work and to eat and to sleep? It has to be that there's something much more important, much more noble. And he explains that in the next pasuk, when he says, Tzame'a nafshi l'Elokim, I'm thirsty. My soul is thirsty for God. Why is he thirsty? What is David HaMelech searching for? That he describes that he's thirsty. So he says like this, Tzame'a nafshi l'Elokim le'el hay. My soul thirsts for God, for the living God. Matai avo v'ra'e pnei Elohim. When will I come and behold the face or the countenance of Hashem? Because when will that day come that I will be close enough to be able to relate to Hashem? Now, David HaMelech always had a connection. And he's not only talking about himself. He's talking about the Jewish nation, how they once upon a time had a very close relationship, and they've become distant. So he's yearning or longing for that moment to come back, for the time that the Jewish people will come out of the exile and return to Yerushalayim and return to have a temple and to do the service of Hashem as they did once upon a time. What did we do once upon a time? He's going to explain this a little bit more in detail. We went Aliyah LaRegel. We went up three times to Yerushalayim, to the Bet HaMikdash. We all appear there. Imagine all the males from the entire land coming together. What a big reunion. And it wasn't a family reunion, really. It was a reunion with Hashem. And sacrifices were brought. It was a very special time. This, however, this particular point that he says, Mataya Vovere Epne Elokim, is not only about Aliyah L'Regel and only about coming to Jerusalem and about the Beit HaMikdash. It's also the aspiration or the yearning that David HaMelech has, Shetitgale Malchuto Shel Hashem Ba'olam, that Hashem's reign should be revealed in the world, that everybody should come to that realization and come to see it and come to form that connection. So this is something that will be in the future, but he is longing for it. Now, you may be thinking as you're reading this or learning this, why say this? Why is he sharing this with us? It's not something that he said and he wanted only. He's telling us that this is something that we should all want. This is something that we should all express. That is why it's in the Sidurim, in the prayer books. If we were to compose our own prayer, we would have a very difficult time. What should we ask? How should we say it? So the group of sages called Anshei Knesset HaGdolah during the Second Temple era, during the beginning of the Second Temple era, they put together the Sidur, slowly but surely. They composed the various prayers and songs and praises to Hashem so that we should know what to say and when to say. Otherwise, people don't have that kind of a vocabulary. They don't know how to express themselves. So here David HaMelech has in mind everybody. He says, this is what you should ask for. Right? Don't ask for a new car. That's not the kind of thing that you should be thinking about, even though it's okay to get a newer car. But he's saying life is so precious. There are many, many more important things in life than the material possessions that we have. And the most important priority of all is the connection with God. And this is stressed in the Torah. Not only in Tehilim, but David HaMelech has to bring it to our attention because people forget. I mean, why do we still have war? Why are there problems amongst people? Why people can't get along? It's only because they don't know what is a true priority in life, what's really important and what's vanities and what's not worth pursuing. So David HaMelech shares with us, this is what I wanted and this is something that you should want for yourself. Now he uses here the word Elohim. Elohim is judgment. So judgment, in some ways, is harsh. So what this also means is that when God reveals himself and the truth comes out, there will be judgment over those nations that did not follow his word. So in some ways, David HaMelech is asking for that time to come about sooner than later. That the truth should come out, that everybody should be aware that there is a God in this world. He says the words Verae, Pinei Elohim, and I should see the countenance of God, meaning that's more important to me than to eat or to drink. This is what I want. This is all that I ask for. However, in the meantime, there are struggles. David HaMelech did not have an easy life, and since this is predicting the future, he sees that there will be very painful times in the history of the Jewish nation. And he says as follows in the next pasuk, Haitali dim'ati lechem yomav v'layla, be'emor elai kol hayom ayeh Elohecha. My tears have been to me like bread, day and night. When they say to me all day, Ayeh Elokecha, where is your God? So here, what is he saying with lechem, bread? My tears were like bread. Well, bread is something that we have every day. I cried every day. That's one explanation given as to why he compares it to bread. Haitali dimati lechem. It was like a routine, regular regiment of tears that I had. Yomam v'layla, day and night. Others explain that the reason he compares it to bread is because he cried so much he didn't have a need and didn't care to eat. It was, that took the place of his bread, the crying about the future, about what he saw. So he cried day and night. What bothered him the most, when he hears everybody, who's his enemy, saying, "Where's your God? You believe in God? How could he allow so many millions of people to die in the Holocaust?" As an example. This complaint, or this, what's the word for it, huh?
Claim.
Not only claim. This way of teasing. It's been around a long time. Yeah. Let your God come and save you. You believe in God? Let's see if he will do anything about it. Or how could you explain that there is a God if this happens? How could a merciful God allow something like this? So this obviously pained him the most. But he emphasizes that his cry was regular, because that's what he wanted. He wanted the Geulah, he wanted to see the redemption. And he cried on the Churban, but he cried because of the destruction on a regular basis. Either because he could not see a way of preventing it from happening, because he's a lot before that, or because he wants to go beyond that point. He says, when will we get out of this? Remember, we are in the longest diaspora ever, almost 2,000 years. So his desire for the Geulah, his great desires, and his pain for the Churban were constant, because this is what was on his mind. Next pasuk, Ele eskara v'eshpecha alay nafshi, ken ki evor basach adadem ad bet Elohim bekor igna v'todah hamon chogeg. This is a little bit difficult. It's a long pasuk, so we'll do our best to translate it. He wants to reminisce. I think that's a good word to choose in English for this. Even though eskra means to remember, reminisce means to call, to recall. To recall something from the past. So, I recall veshpecha alay nafshi, and I pour my soul out. When I recall ki evor basach, according to one interpretation, what that means is when people would come together to Yerushalayim in covered chariots, or when they would come in multitudes, according to another interpretation, and when they would all come, adadim, we would be walking leisurely, slowly, because there's so many people, nobody's rushing. And seeing this beautiful sight of so many people coming together and walking all the way ad bet Elohim, until the house of God, and they would do so bekol rina, with the sound of rejoicing, v'todah, and thanksgiving, hamon chogeg, the multitudes, the many people would be celebrating. So what is he reminiscing here? He's reminiscing the good times, the days where Am Yisrael would come together, go together, celebrate together. And then it's no longer. Why is he telling us to reminisce, to compare? I was thinking of an idea when I was reviewing this pasuk. Comparison. Comparing the good old days with days that may not be as good. Do we gain anything from comparing? On the contrary, it makes us feel bad. Yes, but when it comes to the relationship with Hashem, when it comes to the Churban HaBayit, the destruction of the temple, it's important for us to compare what we had and what we lost, because we want it back and we can get it back. That's the difference. You can't get back your youth, I'm sorry to tell you. You know, there's a lot of perhaps good memories, perhaps not so good memories, but to get back what you had once is not always easy. But relationship with Hashem, this is something that is yours, that you could have back. Ele eskera, I want to reminisce, veshpecha alay nafshi, pour out my soul from within me. How, when we traveled to Yerushalayim, it was the most beautiful sight to behold so many people celebrating together. So as I was going through this pasuk, I thought to myself, imagine a husband and wife who have been married for 30 years, and now they want to get divorced. They're upset, they're not getting along, having many arguments. Sir, Mrs., take a deep breath, sit down, and reminisce about your past. The good old days, the first 10 years of your marriage. Weren't they nice and special with those little babies? And you both shared them together. You went to the park together. We talked about a couple that did have good years. I'm not talking about somebody that from the very start, they were at war with each other. People started off fine. Think back what you had and what you lost because of some stupid arguments that you may have had, because of the mother-in-law, because of some other issue that interfered. Not you, your mother-in-law. This happens. People who are really good for each other, and they were very successful with each other. What happened? Look back. You celebrated. Remember that 10th anniversary? Remember that cake he bought you? Remember that gift that he hid underneath your pillow to surprise you? Remember that anniversary card that she wrote you? How she spent time choosing the words? Isn't that interesting? How sometimes people just forget and erase from their memory the good? There's always the good, the bad, and the ugly, right? We always have that in life. Look away from the ugly. You see a beautiful apple. You know those ones that are red and green, colorful on the outside, really juicy, crispy, tasty. But you see a corner that is brown, that is rotting. Are you going to throw away the whole apple? I hope not. You're going to cut away the part. Same thing with bananas, you know. They always become brown very, very quickly. Are you going to throw away the whole banana with just a little bit of it is brown? You cut away the bad spot, the portion that's spoiled. In life, it takes maskil. That's why he started off with the word maskil. It takes intelligence to figure out how to get along with that which we do not like. We can't run away from it. You have to know how to deal with it. So I think that this is a very important idea, that even though nobody mentions it over here, it has nothing to do necessarily with what David HaMelech is talking about, but it's a similar concept that he wants to ingrain in us. Enlighten yourself. Stop and think about what you had and what you lost. Well, in life, stop and think about it too. In your marriage, in your other relationships. And this will do some good perhaps too. You like this example? I mean, I think it's something that could be of great use to couples. So now David HaMelech comes to a conclusion. In the meantime, we don't have the Geulah yet, we don't have the redemption. So what should we do? So he's talking to himself, but he's also talking to every one of us. Matishtochachi nafshi, why are you so downcast? Tishtochachi, bending down. Nafshi, my soul. Vatehemi alai. And you are, tehemi is like you're wailing. You feel sad, depressed, you're down. Right now it's not a time to be down. That's not going to help you. Depression is not going to help you. You know what may help you? I shouldn't say may, for sure will help you. Something that is a guarantee help is ohili. Ohili l'Elohim ki od odenu yeshuot panav. Ohili in English is translated as to have hope, But I would also add that it's not just hope, it's to look forward. Hope is more tikva, kavel Hashem. Ochili is really more of a looking forward, of a yearning. That the time will come, the day will come, that Hashem will take you out of the diaspora. So therefore, have this hope in you. Continuously hope that it could happen at any moment. And that is what we are instructed to do. We believe in complete faith in the coming of the Mashiach, and it can happen any day. And even if it is delayed, we will still look forward to his coming. Tremendous, important principle of Judaism, because it strengthens our faith, it strengthens our connection with Hashem, it instills in us hope, especially in difficult times. So don't be downcast. Have hope in God, because the time will come. Kyododenu Yeshuot Panav, I will thank him, thank Hashem, for his Yeshuot, for his deliverance, for his salvation, of his Panav, of his countenance, of his face. What does Panav have to do with this? Yeshuot, Yeshuotav, Yeshuato, his deliverance. Why say the Yeshuot of his Panav, of his face, of his countenance? Well, one idea that comes to mind is that the galut, the diaspora, is compared to a hester panim. God's face is concealed from us. We don't see him. It's not so obvious. So when he turns to us, then it is when we see his yeshuot. Then it is when we see the miracles. So yeshuot panav is when he returns to us, when he reveals himself to us, when we can actually see him. Not that we see him, because there's nothing to see, but we see him in action. The miracles are much more visible, more revealed, even though there are miracles all the time, we don't always see them. So there will come a time, David HaMelech says, that I will thank him, because one of these days, hopefully very soon, we're going to begin to see, we're already beginning to see, all the miracles which clearly point that Hashem is slowly but surely revealing himself to the world. Just like the light of the dawn, in Shir HaShirim, the Song of Songs, the Shlomo HaMelech says that the redemption will be like the light of the dawn. It first is a very, very dim light, a small light, but as the sun begins to rise, it becomes brighter and brighter. And eventually, it's crystal clear that the sun has come out, that the whole world is illuminated. And that is the coming of the Mashiach, when the world will be illuminated with his light. What else will we celebrate? What else will we thank Hashem for when he reveals himself? We will thank him not only for taking us out of the diaspora, we will thank him for all the time that he has protected us during the diaspora, miracles that we were unaware of. As the rabbis tell us in the Midrash, it is like a sheep that's surrounded by 70 wolves. Don't think the sheep is so strong that it can defend itself. It is Hashem who is the shepherd, who is protecting us from the 70 wolves, in other words, from all the nations of the world. So there will come a time that we will realize, we don't all know it now, even now we have reason to thank him, but then it will be clear to us, we will have even more reason to thank him then. So this ochili is actually a consolation of sorts. When a person has hope, it helps him. It helps him deal with the problem. Even though that help is not coming right away to him, in other words, the salvation, but the hope in itself is a big help. Next pasuk, Zayin. Elohai alai nafshi tishtochach al kin eskorcha Me'eretz Yarden v'Hermonim me'har mitz'ar. This pasuk is also a little bit difficult to understand. He says, my God, my soul is downcast. My soul is downcast upon me. Because I remember you from the land of Jordan and Hermon, the mountains of Hermon, the peaks, and from the mountain of Yitzhar. It doesn't seem to be very clear what exactly he's trying to communicate. But this is also reminiscing the past. What happened in these mountains, or what happened in this land of Jordan? According to one interpretation, David HaMelech is talking about the past history of the Jewish people, our forefathers, how they were in Har Mitzar. Har Mitzar is a small mountain. Which one is a small mountain? Sinai, where we got the Torah, where Hashem took us through the Jordan, through the Hermonim, through all the mountains in that area, on the way to Eretz Yisrael. And even though we sinned, and even though we caused a lot of trouble, still, He kept His promise and took us through and brought us to Eretz Yisrael. So, Al Kin Eskorchami, I will remember the past, so much that You did for us in the past, even though we misbehaved, even though we sinned. And therefore, He's going to follow up with the next pasuk. Since You were so kind to us, and did so much for us, and demonstrated Your hashgacha, Your supervision over us, then why are things so bad right now? They're so bad, He explains in the next pasuk, that tehom el tehom kore lekol tzinorecha, kol mishbarecha vigalecha alay avaro. Like I told you, these pasukim are going to be a little bit tough. Basically, the translation is like this. Tehom el tehom. Tehom means the depth of the oceans. So the depth, call to the depth. Kore lekol tzinorecha. And they call at the roar, the sound of tzinorecha, your channels. Kol mishbarecha vigalecha alay avaru, all your breakers and waves. You know what breakers are? Like waves. Swept over me. Again, another pasuk which is hard. But he's talking about tzarot. The theme of this pasuk has to do with all kinds of problems that the Jewish nation has experienced. And it's not just the problems. It's that they were tehom el tehom. This is all a description of one after another. Instead of trying to figure out why he chooses these words, it's a little difficult. Just think of the main idea. He's describing how the tzarot were made more difficult because they were one after another. Depth, as he says, calls to depth. One issue after another. Lekol tzidorecha. Through all the channels, in other words, through all the means and through all the ways that they came, in so many ways, in so many places, and kol mishbarecha vigalecha, and the waves came over him. Now, came over him is also beneficial. He didn't drown. Okay? So he realizes this. In other words, the simple understanding is all of this overwhelmed him. All of this overwhelmed us. One after another, wave after wave, empire after empire, everybody persecuted us. You know how many times they were exiled from so many countries in Europe? Just about every country in Europe, if you read the history, they were kicked out, the community, the Jewish communities there. So one after another. Rabbis tell us that sometimes we have waves coming at us. And these waves are symbolic of tyrants. Tyrants. Rodan. Or all kinds of difficult times that we have it very difficult dealing with them. We don't know how to avoid them. Rabbis tell us, just be careful not to fight back. Think of it as a wave. Let the wave go over your head. Don't try to fight it. If it's too strong, it will drown you. Let it just go over you. So bend down when you see a big wave, and let it just go over your head. and continue to float. Very important idea, when you see a situation which is very difficult, or you see an individual, a tyrant, who makes all kinds of, issues all kinds of very difficult decrees, if you can easily, convince him to cancel them, that's fine, but sometimes it's very difficult. When you're dealing with an enemy, bow your head down. If he's too strong for you, don't try to fight him, because it could be that this is what needs to be for now. And humble yourself, and you will stay alive. And David HaMelech, even though he's describing here as difficult times that the Jewish nation experienced or will experience in the future, he's saying, don't forget that these waves went over their head, meaning that they nonetheless survived against all the odds. So many stood up against them, as we say in the Haggadah, "Bechol dor v'dor omdim aleinu l'chalutenu, v'Hashem matzilenu miyadam." In every generation they stood up against us. So many have stood up and tried all kinds of plots, but the waves just went over and the Jewish people are still around. Next pasuk, Yomam yetzave Adonai hasdo v'layla shiro imi tefila le'el hayai. By the day, Hashem ordains His kindness, and by night, His song is with me. Tefila le'el hayai, a prayer to God of my life. Anybody understand what he's saying here? Hashem ordains or instructs His kindness during the day. Well, why not at night? And His song at night. This is also a very famous pasuk that the rabbis talk about at length. Many ideas are being expressed over here. Day and night is a very significant, I guess we can say, two very opposites, day and night, and they represent all kinds of things that are opposite. The day is Olam Haba, when Mashiach comes, when things are clear. The night is Galut, the diaspora. There's no light, it's dark, it's not easy. So Yomam Yetzaveh Hashem Chasdo, when will He ordain His kindness? When will the kindness be in full display? When Mashiach comes. Right now, Balayla, at night, we have Shiroimi, we have His song. What does that mean? We have to give praise and song to Hashem for what we have. Whatever we have is good. It's not the ultimate kindness. The ultimate kindness will be during the day. But in the meantime, we have Shiro. As they say in English, sometimes just count your blessings. And there are many, many blessings that we can count. Look back at your history and look what Hashem has done for you until now. That's Shiro. That's the song. When we sing to Hashem, we're singing and thanking for what we already know. But that's nothing in comparison to what will be when Mashiach comes, because that will be Yetzaveh Hashem Chasdo, when He will ordain, when He will instruct, when He will send all His kindness with outstretched arms. That will be a whole different kind of an experience. So that's one way of understanding the difference between day and night. The diaspora versus what will be in Olam Haba. The rabbis, however, tell us that whoever learns at night Torah, chut shel chesed matuach alav bayom, chut shel chesed nimshach alav bayom, a thread of grace will be on him, will be spread on him during the day. What does it mean, a thread of grace will be on him the following day? A thread of grace is an expression in, I guess, rabbinic Hebrew, which describes a very, very strong love that Hashem shows an individual. And as a result of that strong love, he has an exceptional Shemirah, exceptional protection from above. So learning at night, when people are asleep, when one wants to identify with the pain of the Shekhinah, that there's no temple now standing, during that delicate time of the day, in other words, the night, one deprives himself of sleep. One gets up and learns. Usually that's midnight and beyond, not the first part of the night. It's very special. It's a very special time to be learning Torah. So rabbis learn from this pasuk that Yitzaveh Hashem Chasdo, for one who's Balayla Shiro, for the one who is learning or singing the praise of Hashem at night. The reason why he says Tefillah Le'el Chayai, that a prayer to the God of my life, is that even though things are tough during the night and during the Galut, one should still pray. One should still ask for Hashem to protect one during this time of the Galut, during this time of night. In other words, we always thank Hashem, regardless of the situation we're in. As the rabbis tell us, Tzach levarech al ra'a kishem shem levarech al ha'tova. You have to thank Hashem even on something that does not appear to be so good for you, but it's always beneficial. It's always going to be good for you somehow. So we always praise Hashem and thank Hashem. Nonetheless, tefillah le'el chayai. Don't forget to pray. To pray to Hashem that He should always continue to give you a good life. Next pasuk, Omra le'el sal'i, lama shechachtani, lama koder elech melachatz oyev. I say le'el sal'i, I say to Hashem, my rock. Remember, we've spoken about this in the past when he describes Hashem as a rock, as something solid, as something that you can rely on, something that is immovable, something that is unmovable. You cannot move it from where it is. It's compared to a sela, a rock. So, I say to Hashem, who was my rock, now was someone that I can rely on all the time. Lama shechachtani, why does it appear that you have forgotten me? Why must I walk? Lama koder elech v'lachatz, why must I walk in gloom under the oppression, the lachatz of the enemy? David HaMelech is not complaining here. He never complained, Chas v'shalom. He's asking, why are things different now? At one time, I was able to rely on you, things worked fine, just fine. But somehow, everything is against me now. Everybody's against me. And David HaMelech did have a difficult time, more than the average person, with enemies. Why must I now suffer under the oppression of the enemy? What has happened? What's so different right now? It's so tough, he says, that beretzach be'atzmotai cherfuni tzorerai be'omram elai kol hayom ayeh Elohecha. Like a sword in my bones, beretzach be'atzmotai. Cherfuni tzorerai. Cherfuni means to disgrace, to look down, to despise, to insult. My enemies are always making fun of me, insulting me, telling me off. Kol hayom, the entire day, Ayeh Elohecha, where is your God? Like we said before, this is something that was used against him. And this has bothered him, it was like a sword in his bones. Not because he was in pain for himself, but because of the Chilul Hashem, the desecration of God. So this is what bothered him the most, he says. He finishes up this perek by saying, however, nonetheless, still, Matish tochachi nafshi. Why be so downcast, my soul? Matehemi alai. In other words, why wail? Why wail within me? What did we say before? Ohilin Elohim. Just have hope in Hashem. Just look forward to His salvation, because there will come a time killed odeno yeshuot panayim v'lohai. There will come a time that I will thank Him because He's my deliverance, the light of my countenance and my God. In other words, I will one day thank Hashem and realize that everything that he has done for me was for the good. So in the meantime, just hope and don't feel bad and don't be downcast. Important lesson for all of us in any situation is that being sad does not help. And on the contrary, things can turn around in a very short time. So that is the best cure. Besides prayer, of course, and he says that many times, besides prayer, trust in Hashem. Turn to Hashem, and you will see how things will turn around. The next chapter is only 5 Pesukim, and it really pretty much ties into this one. So we're just going to continue with it. By the way, before we begin the next chapter, the word Yeshuot Panai, here he doesn't say Panav. As he said before, Hashem's countenance, Hashem's face. Here he says his face. He's my deliverance, the light of my countenance. Why does it say my countenance, my face? It could be that he's saying how the enemies will be able to see it on his face, how he's been saved, how Hashem has delivered him. In other words, here he was sad, here he was downcast. There will come a time when they will be able to see it on my face, his Yeshuot. That's why he says it this way. The next perek, Shofteni Elohim veriva revi migoy lo chasid miish milma ve'avlat tefaleteni. Very, very powerful and important pasuk here. He's talking here about the hypocrites. He's talking about individuals and nations who are not kind-hearted, even though they may appear to be. Look at the words he uses. Shofteni, judge me or avenge me, really. Hashem. V'riva rivi, and take on or champion my cause. Against who? Migoi lo chasid. A nation that is not a righteous nation, impious nation. Me'ish mirma. Rescue me from the man of deceit, ve'avla, tefaleteni. Rescue me from a man of deceit and iniquity. Why choose to describe a nation as being lo chasid, not righteous? Just say an evil nation, a bad nation, a nation that is lo chasid. So what's the remedy? What's the insinuation here? They appear to be Hasidim. They want to give that appearance. Oh, we really care about you. We want to help you. But they're not. And why use the word, why use the description, the example of Ish Mirma, man of deceit? Because it's the same idea. There are some people that on the surface, they will appear to be your friend. They want to help you, but they're not. And the problem is that here he's referring to especially Jewish people who became mumarim, became traitors against the Jewish nation by trying to please the Gentiles, by trying to please the enemy. See, we're with you, we're against them. They want to please so much that there's an expression, they want to be more Catholic than the Pope. You hear that one? That's the idea. And there are people till today who are mirma, deceit. They're no good. And they are from amongst us. They live within us. The enemy within. So here, he lumps them together, Hashem. Champion my cause from this kind of individuals who may give the appearance that they're righteous, but they're totally not righteous. On the contrary, they're acting deceitful. Ki ata Elohei ma'uzi, lama ze nachtani, lama koderet alech belachatz ayom. Now you will notice that some of it is repetition. It appears to be that he said this before, but the reason he does that is for greater emphasis. He says, "You are ma'uzi. You are my source of strength. God, you are my strength." Then why lama zenachtani? Why does it appear? Now I'm adding the words, why does it appear? Because otherwise it doesn't sound too good to just translate. Lama zenachtani, why did you abandon me? Because he's not really saying that. He's saying, why does it appear that you abandoned me? Why do I need to continue downcast or in gloom under the oppression of my enemy? Same thing as he said in the previous perek. He says, I was expecting that this should all be gone. That I was expecting that the enemy should already no longer exist. I was expecting for all the pain and suffering to end. Why is it still continuing on? If you are my strength, you can do it just like that. Right? We sometimes would love for things to be resolved just like that. Why does it take so much time? Even though he knows in the end it will be okay, but why take so much time? What is the reason for all of this? What do I ask for? He's going to talk about light. And we have to understand why. So look at Pasuk Gimel, if you have the Tehilim. Shlach orecha v'amitecha, hema yanchuni. Send me your light and your truth. They will guide me. Hema yanchuni, they will guide me. Yevi'uni, they will bring me in har kodshecha to the mountain of God, in other words, to your holy mountain, ve'el mishkerotecha, and to your sanctuary, to your sanctuaries. The light and your truth. David HaMelech is concerned for the Jewish nation that they will have all kinds of oppressors, one of them being not a physical oppressor, but one who will try to use deceit to mislead them, to brainwash them, and to cause them to abandon their faith with falsehood, with deceit. That's another kind of enemy. We had that with the Greeks. No physical oppression, but all kinds of other philosophies. So there's always a danger, always, not just back then, even today, there's always a danger of the mind being contaminated with all kinds of philosophies that are alien to Judaism. And he's asking for Hashem to protect us from that. So therefore he asks for light. Send your light and send your truth. Who is your light and who is your truth? Rabbis tell us that this is describing Moshe and Aharon. Moshe and Aharon, Moshe representing the light, Aharon representing the truth because of the Urim and Tumim that he wore, the breastplate, the decisions that were made through him. But here it also represents Mashiach and Eliyahu HaNavi. Mashiach represents the light, how he will illuminate the world. And Eliyahu HaNavi, the way I explain it, represents the truth here because he will settle many, many questions that the rabbis say should remain the way they are. In other words, we don't have a solution to them until Eliyahu HaNavi arrives, and he will resolve many of the questions that we have. Either way, you need the two. You need the light of Mashiach, you need the truth of that era, when the truth will come out, to be able to deal with all this deceit that we have right now. You can't fight it. It's going to be around. Therefore, Shelach Orcha v'amitecha, Hema yanchuni, so they can guide me and bring me back to where I want to be, to the Bet HaMikdash, to your sanctuary. And what will happen then? Va'avo el mizbach Elohim el el simchat gili evodecha bechinor Elohim Elohai. And at that point, I will come to the altar of Hashem, and El, that was my God, simchat gili, the joy of my delight, vodecha bechinor, and I will thank you with a kinor. You know what a kinor is? It could be a harp. Today they use the word kinor for violin, but there was also a musical instrument called a lyre, L-Y-R-E, that looks like a small harp that the Greeks used to use a lot. It has a beautiful, beautiful sound. Looks like a small harp, L-Y-R-E, if you want to look it up. And I will therefore thank you at that point with a kinor Elohim Elohai, in other words, O God, my God. he's being very expressive now. He will be so thankful. Because at that point, everything will be so clear that his thanks to Hashem will be in the most expansive way possible. It was even with a musical instrument. It says Bechinor. It's not just words of praise. At that point, when Mashiach comes, we will realize that everything that happened, even the Holocaust, was for a good cause. Can you imagine how much joy we will have then? Oh, you mean they're not gone forever? You mean they're coming back? There's such a thing called Tchiyat HaMetim, a resurrection? You mean all those that were burned to ashes, all of a sudden, they didn't disappear? But they made them into soap. But they drowned in the seas. They were burned in the crematoriums. No, here they're back. And that the verse says, Azi Malech Sechok Pino. Our mouth will be full of laughter, of joy. When we say, it was just a bad dream. And that time is coming soon, by the way. This is Bezat Hashem, this generation. It's going to be an incredible sight to behold. He says, I want to get there, David HaMelech says. I want to then approach the Mizbeach and thank Hashem properly. Today, we can't be as thankful. Well, yes, you could, but not in the same way because we are not allowed to have all that music. According to the customs of various communities, especially in Yerushalayim, you can't have as much music in your weddings. Because of the Churban HaBayit, ever since the destruction of the Beit HaMikdash, our simcha is incomplete. We break a glass underneath the chuppah for the same reason. Our joy is incomplete until the Beit HaMikdash is rebuilt. So that's what David HaMelech says, let that time come when I can rejoice completely with you, when I can come to the altar, when I can express my thanks to you in realization that everything that happened in the past throughout our long diaspora was for the good. So once again, the last pasuk is a repetition of the last perek. Therefore, in turning to us, he says, even though he's talking about himself, he says, Mati shtochachi nafshi, why be so downcast, my soul? Mati hemi alai, no reason for you to wail. Ochili lelohim, just hoping God, ki ododenu yeshuot panai velohai, the time will come that we will see that he's my deliverance. The light of my countenance, panai, once again he says, the light of my countenance, the lohai and my God. So Hashem is my deliverance. And therefore, there's no reason to feel bad, there's no reason to feel depressed. Hope in Hashem is the best cure. The additional emphasis over here that David HaMelech is reminding us by repeating the same verse is that just don't forget that salvation is in the hands of Hashem. Whenever you see a difficulty, whenever you see some big problem, war, or someone is the leader of your nation is a wicked and evil man, and there's all kinds of persecutions, regardless, if you're confronting such a situation, just remember, the address is up there, not Uncle Sam, not Air Force, armies and all that. Remember, Ochili Lelokim, that's the one you have to hope in. That's the one where you have to put your hope in. That's the one where you have to turn to. And other than that, there's no other solution. So, because of the situation that we're in today, where there's a lot of chaos everywhere, the same thing. We shouldn't feel sad, downcast, depressed. The economy is not doing well. People are having a hard time. Yes, I mean, we should feel bad for them. We should continue to pray and to hope. And not forget that any day, Bezat Hashem, we're going to hear good news. And it will be our turn to thank Hashem for everything that He has done and for what He's doing now. For what Bezat Hashem, what He will continue to do. The segula of this two perakim is the same segula as the one for chapter 41. Somebody's in trouble, about to lose his job. They want to replace him with someone else. Say these chapters. Say that any one of these three chapters three times. It's a very strong segula. It has the power of protection. Oh. for some reason, it works with the job, but I'm sure it could work with other things too. I think that these parakim have one important common theme, especially the last two, and it's to remind us to not lose hope. Regardless of the situation we're in, is to always turn to Hashem because He is our hope. Amen.